already very curious where you are from, which countries are you in at the moment. So if you could write that in your chat box, if you like, I would love to see it. I'm right now located in Vienna. I've lived half of my life in Asia, in China, and also in Thailand, and are back now in Europe and very excited that I was able to meet ChildHub online and that you invited me to hold the webinar today. So it's my pleasure to do that. Okay, super. I'm reading here, Croatia, UK, Montenegro, Albania, Hungary, Romania, Ljubljana. Great. Super. Okay. Yeah, if there's still some of you want to write, let me know. Would be really happy to know where you're from. Yeah. So short introduction about myself. I've started my journey with this topic of children, attachment and trauma 30 years ago in China, working with handicapped children there in an orphanage. And there I started really to think about love and how can people become loving or grow up and be able to give love and receive love. And I realized quickly often weekend, and I wasn't able to change a whole system or like an organization or how school is run, but I can give drop by drop love. And love is love, if I own a second with a child, to influence them so they are able to develop more inner safety. And so this was the motivation starting this work. In my first profession, I was a preschool teacher, and then I got training, and now I'm working as a psychological counselor and specializing on helping people to develop and grow and heal from developmental trauma, but also just to people, helping people to become alive and reach their goals and be able to live from their heart. And Corona helped me in a way that I'm now training online students from Asia mainly who want to help others who have trauma, and I do online training there and also online counseling. Yeah, so today we are talking about really how to improve children's lives so they can become more safe. And I have also a few pictures here. No, here it is. These are just a few impressions of the people I've worked with in the past, and they are all working with children or with adults with trauma. And here in our trainings, we are really practicing connection, practicing how to get in touch with a child that is not obviously maybe wanting our connection. And so it's always more easy if you can get into role plays and into practice and then apply what you learn rather than just learning knowledge. Yeah, so today we also do one or two exercises. I will not be teaching the whole time, but also give you something to practice where you are now. Yeah, as I said already, children in institutions often deal with low levels of love. And I like to give you four short stories. And those stories of four different children are showing you, introducing to you different attachment styles of children. There is one safe secure attachment, and then there's also three attachment types that are the insecure attachment types. So let me introduce to you one boy. I call him Joe. He's quite resilient. I met him in the orphanage, and he could go to school, and he even could remember then that when he was about 5 years old, that he had lived in the countryside, and then his mom brought him to the city. He remembered seeing the many lights at the train station and in the city, and she left him there so that he could be found and brought to the orphanage, because he was handicapped and he had cerebral palsy. He was not able to grow up and help and work. And he was quite resilient when I met him. He was 10 years old, and he had friends. When he was frustrated, he could show his frustration, but he could also play and calm himself. He could develop with other boys. And although he had his handicap, he was able to make friends in school also. So this boy, I would say he was mostly secure attached, although he had this moment and possible trauma of loss in his life, being left by his mom. But I think it was, you could see that he had a good and strong foundation. The first 5 years of his life, he did have mostly secure attachment from how he developed then in the following years. Yeah, another boy, I call him Lolo. He was 8 years old, and he was a boy. He lived in a tiny room by himself. He only had his father. He didn't have his mom anymore. And the father was a migrant worker, meaning wherever he got a job, that's where the father had to move. And so this boy was staying left behind, staying back in his little room. And when the social worker met this boy, she met a boy that was very self-sufficient. He didn't show any problems that he would need. He didn't show any need for help. He managed on his own, as if, he was an adult already. Although he had also to ask his neighbors for food, but it all didn't seem a problem. So the social worker, she committed to meet this boy regularly once a week, because she realized, there is an eight-year-old boy does need relationships, and he's so self-sufficient. It doesn't seem like a secure attachment. And so his style would be mostly avoidant, because he would not seek help from others, he would not mention his needs, he would be by on his own and not seek connection. Another girl, I call her Lily. She was 7 years old, and I've heard about this girl from her teacher, who is a student in my training program. And she said that the girl is sometimes, she's very clingy. She doesn't leave the teacher out of her attention. She's always wanting her attention. And when then, as a teacher has to do, sometimes have to say, no, sit down, I have other students here, then she would become upset. She, the teacher would see, she would frown at the teacher, look very unhappy, and be upset at the teacher. And otherwise, when she wasn't as upset, she would be very clingy. Yeah, this we can call mostly ambivalent attachment. It's this back and forth. The child wants to be very close and is close to the adult, and she's afraid of losing this connection with the adult and then getting upset when she's feeling she's losing the connection with the person. Yeah, another boy I want to introduce to you is I've met him in an institution, and what I was seeing and hearing from others that he was stealing, he would be often violent, and he would then also become attached to the most powerful people in the system, so maybe the leader of the institution. Wouldn't have any friendships with his peers, and one day he would come very close and be very nice, and another day he would be very unpredictable and aggressive, so you would never know how he would be on the next day. So, and with this boy, we can say he's most likely showing a disorganized attachment pattern. Yeah, so love is crucial, and every human being has love needs, and we are born for connection. Attachment, sorry, I just need to take this poll away here. It's okay, wait a moment, sorry. Yeah, so when we look at attachment, love needs and attachment are a special form of emotional relationship, and this kind of relationship involves that it's mutual, it's both ways, it's not a one-way relationship that one is always giving and the other always receiving, but it's both ways. So there's comfort and safeties, and both individuals enjoy the relationship. So, and then bonding is really what you do together that is creating this relationship and bond. And here you see three pictures of mother-child bonding. And you see those three different cultures and how attachment is expressed differently in different cultures. For example, Chinese moms and babies, they would not lie on the floor and play on the floor. The babies would be either quite close or to the attachment person, or they would sit in a bed or in a chair, but never on the floor. And you see the picture of the African mom, how they are together, and the picture here of the more Western mom and child relationship. I think in the West, we think toys are very important. And I learned when I lived in China that actually we don't have to have toys. There's other ways too. So when we have, now my PowerPoint is not moving. I might have to stop and start the PowerPoint again. Not sure what's happened.
Tina, maybe click with the mouse. Sometimes you need to click with the mouse on the PowerPoint.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Very good. Very good. You have done it more often. I think this is good. Okay. Thank you. Good. Good. Here we have, what does it need for a relationship, a safe relationship? You can say you need a parent, a child, and a relationship. So it's not enough to have a parent and to have a child. Without the relationship, it's not attachment. Yeah, and attachment, a good picture is like it's glue. And when you have this watery glue and it dries up, it doesn't stick anymore. So if you have a live attachment, it's like sticky glue in a positive sense. It's putting this relationship together. Yeah, just a few facts and let's see. We have one way of think of attachment in different types is here the secure type, which is secure attachment, and then insecure attachment, which would be the avoidant pattern, the ambivalent pattern, and the disorganized or stemming from developmental trauma pattern. These are the examples I gave you in the beginning of those four different children. Attachment is happening generally between 9 months and before 5 years old. So when there's attachment problems, they don't start in later in life or in as a teenager. If it's an attachment problem, it's already starting in those first five years of life. So let me see. Where is this one? Yeah, so when you have attachment needs in the child and they are not met by their main caregivers, does not have to be the mom, it could also be the grandma, the father, the auntie, it's the person who is with the child most of the time and most sensitively caring for the needs of the child. Oops, sorry, I'll hear this again. So since attachment and love is such a basic human need, we are biologically made for connection. This is when a child is born, it seeks the connection with the mother. It can be soothed if the mother is there or the main caregiver and who is caring for this child. So when our attachment needs or the needs of children in the first years are not met, there is some intensive responses. And so these responses can be that the child is protesting, screaming. It can be the child would be very clingy because there's the need for love. There might be depression. The children become very silent, very withdrawn, or even despair, like really giving up on life because the needs are not met. And then these children can become really lifeless if this neglect is going on, if there's no emotional connection, to the point that they could die without the human connection. Yeah, or they detach from life. So we are really, when we are talking about the need for inner safety, for having these secure relationships, we are really talking about a very basic need. Yeah, when I like to show you here our a model that I'm using to understand how the whole person is put together. And so here you can see written in red, I try to put my remote No, my control here. Let's see. No, wait, sorry. Okay. So here in red, you see five ways. Here you have the environment. Where does the child live? Where does the person live? City, countryside, the culture, whatever the surrounding is. Then you see the social. So the social, if you move around this circle, like from social going to the right, you have friends, present family, significant others, family of origin, higher power, like if they have a spiritual friend or relationship, work and school, professional support, lay support, or other groups or church or NGOs, groups that are part of their life. And then when you move up into the circle, you have the physical. So this is really in the physical part of the human. Here you have the behavior and also many other aspects, but because it's a complex model, I just want to show you this part of the physical, the behavior, because this is what we see. It's like if you would have a movie, you would see behaviors. If you would turn off the tone of your movie and just see what people do without hearing what they say, then that's what is behavior. And this is what you see when you work with children. You see their behavior. And as you see here, this is quite on the outside of the person. This is the behavior is not the truth about them or doesn't show their inner needs, but it does show something is going on. And then when we move in here, we have, besides the physical part of the person, there's the mind, there's the emotions in there, the thinking. And then move into the heart. And here in the heart, you have different words again, but I want to leave you here, guide you here to love. And this is the part where attachment would fit the love needs. How full or empty is the love tank of a person? If you imagine you're in your heart, you have a water tank, and depending on how much you have received or you were able to receive, might be more full, more empty. This is what we call love tank. And here in the love tank, this is where we experience love. So what is love? When I talk about love, which is then creating the inner safety, this is the place in us where we feel security, safety, trust, worthiness. It's really starting from the beginning when we are in our mother's womb into childhood and adulthood. And everyone had this experience that was love when you were in your mother's womb and you felt the warmth, you felt the rhythm, you were protected. This is how the child experiences a sense of feeling loved, accepted, and everyone had that. So this is a really good thing when we think of problems with love. Everyone has a basis where they did experience love. And then the bonding and secure attachment that will foster this sense of love. Let me show you this one. Where is it? And so here, yeah, this is what we would, what I would define with what love is: belonging, knowing who are my people, where would I run when I'm in, when I don't feel safe, when my inner safety is low, who can I run to? So this is a question you can work out with this child, for example. So who, where would they feel safe? Who can make them feel safe? Is there a place? Is there a person? And if they don't have that, then you have a good indicator that they are missing inner safety. Yeah, belonging, again, if children are displaced or they have lost family members, where is, do they have a sense of belonging? Is there belonging in school or maybe only with friends, or is there adults also that give them this sense of belonging? Yeah, and love and acceptance would be the opposite of rejection and shame. Yeah, feeling shamed for existing. If there's trauma, it can be very likely that someone feels ashamed, yeah, either to exist or ashamed for what happened to them. And the antidote is love and acceptance, just accepting for the of the person unconditionally. So yeah, I have this. I try to move my thing here that I can read it, but doesn't work. Okay. Yeah, and trust, of course. When we experience inner safety, then we have a trust. Trust in a person, trust in a system. There has to be some trust that we feel, or a child feels safe on the inside. Yeah, so let me... Okay. Now, okay. Just want to hear, for secure attachment, this, the inner safety, it's really a big, big resilience in a child's life. And it would give you, the child, protection under stress. They have more ability to cope when what love throws at them, what life throws at them, to cope with that. They would be more easier for someone who's securely attached to seek help when they need it. Their creativity is there, and they would be probably more flexible. Yeah. Then when you are working with children with attachment difficulties or even attachment disorders, children would then unconsciously project onto you what they have experienced in their early attachment relationships. So when their attachment wasn't secure, they might see you the same way that you are not secure. So what that would do with you, you might feel, because of the child's inner feelings, you might feel confused when you're with this certain child, or you might feel shocked with this certain child, or frightened, or when you work with a certain child, you might always feel incompetent, like as if you are no one and nothing, or even alone. You might feel very pushed to your limits. And so this can be a sign that a child with attachment difficulties is entangling you in their control or power struggles. And yeah, or they make you feel that they are all fine, they don't need your help, like this boy, the 8-year-old boy I was telling you about, who lived alone in his room. Or they might become very controlling. When you're with them, you feel they are controlling everything. They are making all the choices. Yeah, or they might get upset at you, they blame you, like it's your fault that I'm here like this, it's your fault that my parents are not here. So this is just good for us to know when we are dealing with children who have a very limited inner safety or no inner safety in themselves, that this has an influence also on us. And it's very important to be aware of what is happening inside of us when we are with a child with attachment difficulties. Because when we want to help increase inner safety, we need also be aware of our own insight. Like, how can we help a child with inner safety when we are not in touch with our own insight? And this is where I want to continue now with us, with ourselves. So for yourself, what you can do beyond this webinar, that you get familiar with your own attachment history, then also become friends with your vulnerabilities. That means seeing your weaknesses not as enemies, but as your friends. Get to know your weaknesses, your sensitive spots, and start loving yourself with those. It doesn't mean you have to like your weakness, but it means they're part of you, and you can still build inner safety with those weaknesses also being there. It's like holding both, holding your strength and your weakness. You don't have to do a black-white decision that you're all good or all bad. Nobody's life was perfect. And my favorite sentence when I teach in China is, you're allowed to make mistakes and learn from your mistakes. Depending on the culture you grew up in, for some of us, this was not an option, making mistakes. Maybe for others of us, nobody cared when we made mistakes, so it didn't matter. So yeah, you can learn to make mistakes, not just make them, but learn from them as an adult. And this, when you have these attitudes towards yourself, you can also, without words, transfer this attitude to the children in your care, that they can feel that from you, how you are safe inside of yourself, and they can pick up this safety non-verbally. This is not done by training and talking. It's coming from the inside, from the heart, from your heart as well. What we shared here, the what is love, this is part of your heart. So now I like to do an exercise with you. And we are moving now into how to, more practically, how to increase the inner safety in the children in our care. I like to invite you now to do an exercise just there where you are now in your room at your computer, but you don't have to learn now and study, you don't have to pay attention to the slides. You can just be there now for yourself. If you hold a pen, let the pen down and try to sit comfortably in your chair, or if you like, you can also stand up. This exercise can be done either way. It's not a magic exercise, it's just an awareness exercise, becoming aware of your own being here in the now within your body. So let's switch into a different mode now. And anyway, there's no cameras on, we don't see you. You can just be as if you are alone in your room. And what I like you to do now is just be aware of your body, and I will guide you in this exercise, because we can only change what we are aware of. When I'm not aware, I cannot change. Good. So now I like you to put your attention from your head just down to your feet, to your toes, your feet. You can just sit there where you are and just try with your attention, notice your feet. Or you can also put your eyes there and look at your feet. Just notice them. How are they? Are they soft, or do you hold them a bit cramped? Are they cold or warm? Just notice them. Can you feel your toes? Are they there? Are you noticing them? Your five toes, where are they? Just notice them. Good. Then move up to your hips and just feel how you're sitting there, or how your hips are holding you, holding your legs. See, are they straight or bent? Just notice. And then move up to your head and notice how your head is sitting on your, now I forgot the word in English, how your head is sitting here on this part here, and how your head is held there. And just notice your cheeks here, and your lips, and then the head of your, the top of your head, just on the top here. Just notice it, that this is how tall you are. Yeah, then just take a deep breath. And come back into our teaching room. Yeah. So this body scan is we did it in a very short version now. You can really go through all parts of your body, but it's an important practice, because it trains your attention skills by bringing awareness to your physical sensations. And when you help children with inner safety, this is what you need. You need to be aware of their body, of their sensations as an observer, and you practice that best with yourself. And it helps you to become more aware of the moment-to-moment experience. And it's really, it helps you to get away from judging. We are so used to judge. This is good, this is bad, I should do it better, I should do it like this. So it helps you to take a break from thinking, judging, and all those processes you're doing with your head usually. We are looking here at non-verbal connecting. So this is the part of our brain where we connect with each other, and this is through our, you know, gestures, how we stand, how we move, our facial expressions, our how we have eye contact, the movements, our habits, our emotions. That is what is communicating, and this is what you need to communicate with a child non-verbally to increase their inner safety. So here we have this tool here, those five steps that are showing you that on the bottom you have the connecting, the non-verbal connecting is part of connecting. And this, in every interaction or relationship we have with a child where you want to increase inner safety, you need to keep this connection. Just what we practice now with yourself, and then also observe that in the children. On top of that, you can understand, for example, the attachment style. So what attachment style does this child have? So, and then from this, learn what do they might need. And only then later we need responses. If we have good connection, we need much less responding and doing and, yeah, telling them what to do. So connecting is really crucial. And then we can engage help when there is more help needed, and we can evaluate our work and learn from our mistakes. Yeah. So for the nonverbal connecting, what you need is this mindful attitude. Be curious, for example, what's happening in my body, to be open for the nonverbal. We can connect, build inner safety when we are not judging the child, ourselves, but when we are there with our body, we are giving presence. And when we are there, it's actually a shared thing. Remember, attachment, it's mutual. It's not one person giving all and the other person is not doing anything. It means I'm there 50% with myself, and I'm also 50% my attention with the other, with the child. I'm never 100% with the child, because then I lose myself, and then my inner safety cannot really work for the child. So I'm paying attention to myself and to the child, both of them. And I believe now, I think I have 5 more minutes. Is that right, Vesna?
Yes, you're right.
Okay, good. So let's just practice that for a moment. So paying attention here, what do you notice? Same thing as you noticed your body. When you don't judge, when you just observe, what does the child do here? What movement do you see? What facial expression? And you can write in the chat box, just write down your observation. What do you see? What does the child do from those non-verbals? We have the here eye contact, or the look of the eye, in the eye. We have the facial expression, the body language, the movement, emotions. Mm-hmm. Yes, dancing, we see here. Mm-hmm. Happy face. The girl enjoys it, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How about her body language? How intense is she? Is she very, does she have a lot of tension in her body, or is she, her arms, her face, her neck, is it relaxed? Mm-hmm. Seems she's doing it naturally, connected, relaxed, free, easy. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, good, okay. How about this boy? So I like you now to imagine that this boy is sitting in front of you. And now give your attention to this boy. Get a feel how he feels like. How is this boy? Just from the non-verbals, what do you see? How is he? Would it be safe to give him a safe touch? Just from looking at him, what would he need? Inviting to play together? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So he has an openness. He seems open for you to go there and do the same. Play along with him. Thoughtful, yeah. Mm-hmm. Thrilled. So mindful awareness is really important in helping children with inner safety, because they need to be seen, they need to be heard, they need to be felt. And these are all skills and tools to build their inner safety. So the connecting step is very important, even if you don't understand everything, and even if you find all your responses are no good for this child, go always back to the connecting, because this can be the most important foundation where you then can build up with other responses. So here's what we just practiced. In short, observing eye contact, facial expression, the timing, how fast or slow a child is, the intensity, the movements, the emotions, then safe touch. It's an important topic in each culture that's different. What is safe touch? But there's, of course, basics, what safe touch is. Usually, probably you could say a pat on the shoulder is safe. But you, with observing, you can get a good picture of what is safe for that specific child. And when you are open for this experience, you will get a lot of information from the child, what they need, and how you can help them increase the inner safety. Like here, you're in connection, in interaction. It can be just a second of a smile that is aware of the other person and aware of yourself that can build inner safety. Yeah, so this is so far until here, and okay, now it's slow moving. I have to finish now, but want to show you the invitation, but I will do that for the trauma care training program while we answer your questions. Okay, back to you, Vesna.
Thank you very much, Tina, for this wonderful webinar. I wasn't expecting this kind of really nice exercise in the middle of the webinar, and it was kind of like a very sensory active, but kind of feeling after it much more relaxed and being much more still. So I believe that all of other participants who were here was experiencing very simple thing. I'm now inviting you, if you have any kind of feedback, any kind of questions for our Tina here today. For me, it was really kind of always a really important reminder, really to look at the children, to monitor the whole holistic behavior and the body and the mimic and everything, and to monitor ourselves. I think that this part that you were talking about, especially in the beginning, is about how we feel when we are with the children in some space. Maybe some of the feelings are not our feelings. Maybe some of our feelings is really from the child. So it kind of very good points during the webinar, and like a gentle reminder to monitor all parts, ourselves and the children there that we have in the space. My question was like, you said that you were working in Asia and that you saw that there are some kind of cultural differences is making this kind of attachment with the parent. And you said that, for example, in Asia, it's not very common that the parent is on the floor with the child, like is in the Western countries. Did you see any kind of differences also there that could be really interesting also for us here?
Mm-hmm. So you mean other differences besides lying on the floor?
Yeah.
For example, who expresses affection to who is very different. For example, here in Austria, Germany, people kiss on the streets, or husband, wife, couples, they would, you know, kiss outside where everybody's watching.
Yeah, it's kind of normal.
Yes, it's normal. But then, yeah, in China, you don't do that. You don't show affection, physical affection on the outside.
Okay.
But then you could, two girls, like just friends, they would hold hands and walk on the street. Whereas here, when two girls hold hands, then people think, or maybe they have a relationship.
Yes.
So it's always good not to judge, but
to see the cultural difference.
Observe, this is really interesting. And see the culture. Yeah.
Yes.
And learn from the culture. What does it mean? Yeah.
Thank you. I see one question from Sanya. Mm-hmm. Just a second. I need to get back. I'm wondering, you mentioned attachment child mother. What about attachment with father or other adults?
Yes, it's really attachment is happening with the person who is with the child most of the time and who's most sensitive to the needs of the child. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have, most of the times it is the mother, but it doesn't mean it's always the mom. It can also be a father, for example, or another person who is caring for the child to develop the attachment. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, there is a comment with some people joined after, and they said that they wanted to be here, but they had some electricity problem. Just like feedback, this webinar is recorded, so we will put it on the Child Hub and the YouTube, so you will be able to look at it and to hear it from the beginning if you weren't able to be with us from the beginning today. I see a lot of thank you. So I imagine that I don't see any question. Let me see, just a second. Very useful. Okay. Yes. So if you... One more. Okay. Tina, do you want to maybe present your training program mm-hmm. for the end? Yeah.
Yes. So from those experiences of the last 20 years working in areas, I've put together an online trauma care training program. And this training program is for everyone who is working with people, and especially if you work with children or adults who are traumatized, then this is for you, because in the training program you will learn those topics and skills that are really practical, because I believe trauma is not a topic that belongs just in the hands of psychologists or professionals, but really in everyone's hand who is willing to learn, to be changed, and wants to help others. And so, if you're interested in the training program, it will start in January. Originally, the start was in October, but I moved it to January. And we will start, middle of January. Here you have my email, mmhurasia You can send me an email and I will send you the invitation for the program. It's online classes once a week, 3 times 8 weeks long, once a week. And so wherever you are in this world, you can attend. It's afternoon Europe time.
Yeah, Suela, just asking question, how can we register in your course, please? Mm-hmm. So you said that she needs to send an email, right?
Yes, please send an email and then I send you the information and and then we can, you can go from there.
Yes. Thank you, Tina, very much for your time. Mm-hmm. This was really, really useful, very nice webinar. And I imagine I myself would like to hear a lot more than just for 50 minutes. Like I said in the beginning, this webinar is recorded, so you will be able to listen to it. In a few days, it will be uploaded. Just for the last note, there is a short evaluation poll. Just a second. Please give us a second and click on the best result for you. As I wrote in the chat, if you want to receive a certification of attending this webinar, please write to email info@chalhub.org and you will receive your certificate in a few days. And thank you very much for being with us today. Tina, again, a big thanks to you. Hope that we will see each other also in the future and that we will have opportunity mm-hmm. to host you again on the Chal Hub.
Thank you. I'm very happy I could do this with you in Chal Hub and excited to see you again.
Yes. So thank you very much and I wish to everybody a very nice rest of the day. Goodbye.
Bye.